How many of you ever had this? You run into some room, new to a friend or a spouse or something, and you're like freaking out because you need to leave quickly, but you've lost something. Ever had that? And you can't find it anywhere. Recently, I had this one. I ran into a room that my wife was in, and I'm like, I cannot find my sunglasses. And she said, honey, there. You've had that? Come on, show of hands. Who's actually had that? Okay, good. I don't feel so alone now. These days, I think when it comes to prophecy, I'm like, it's right there in front of us. And I'm not sure that we realize how close it is the day that we live in. And I think that's one of the most exciting things, once a year, just to come as a church and recalibrate ourselves to the potential that Jesus could come at any moment. Now, that could be said at any point in history, but as we move on in history, obviously there is a generation that Scripture talks about that will see the return of the Lord. And there are markers, if you will, signs that point to, what does that time look like? What are the indicators right before the return of the Lord? And what's so exciting for me as a pastor is to every year come and sort of point out a few things. Have we progressed? Have we moved along? And to also notice, I don't know if you notice this, but it gets more intense, like birth pangs, the Bible says, closer together, more intense as we get to the return of the Lord Jesus. And I find myself pinching myself going, this is amazing. It is right in front of us today. Now that creates some problems. Let me illustrate why that creates some problems for you here. Okay, look at these four images. I want you to think for a second. Don't shout it out. Just think in your own head. What do these four images have in common? Let me help you. In 1939, the New York Times said the problem of TV was that there'd be too many people glued to the screen, and so it would never catch on. And obviously, if they could jump forward and see some of us with our cell phones, they'd be horrified. In the 19th century, an English prof said air travel, the second picture that you can see up on the right there. That's the convertible airplane I found online, which is pretty sweet. But anyway, moving over to that picture, a prof in the 19th century said air travel at high speed would be impossible because passengers would suffocate in the process. In the 17th century, King George II said in 1773, he said this, the American colonies had little stomach for revolution, so there was no fear of that ever happening. And then finally, perhaps most famously for some of you, would be the idea that the company that made the Titanic swore that it would be the unsinkable ship. And when it comes to the topic of prophecy, what we're dealing with is the idea of two things in Scripture. It's the word that means to predict or to speak forth truth. So when we're predicting, we're saying this is going to happen or this isn't going to happen. And the Bible says, you know, you have to be careful because false teachers or prophets are those who say something will happen and it doesn't, or who say it won't happen and it does. And so as you go through Scripture, these are some of the things, I think, that can put people off prophecy as a topic. Number one, people's predictions are wrong. The first thing I see is that people, when they make predictions, they kind of ruin it for everyone else, right? I mean, on the Antichrist, there's people who are like, oh, yeah, it's Napoleon. It's Napoleon. And they thought Napoleon was the Antichrist. That's Napoleon taking a selfie. And then he died. And so after that, World War II, they're like, no, it's Hitler. Hitler's the Antichrist. Same result. And then some have said, I'm not even making this up, you can Google it, not during the service, Danny DeVito was the Antichrist, and we really don't know, the jury's still out on that one. But if it's not the Antichrist, it's just a scary thought, isn't it? If it's not the Antichrist, it's the return of the Lord, or it's the rapture of the church. Many of you know, May 21st, 2011, Harold Camping said was the end of the world. And he predicted this would be the rapture of the church in the beginning of the last days, which always astounds me because just about every prophecy Sunday, somebody, it's usually the same two or three of you, but I don't worry, I find it hilarious. You always go, so pastor, and I already had it one time today, so pastor, they catch you in the hall or something, and they go, so, you going to pick a day? You going to pick a day today? Tell us what day, Jesus. And obviously, I will never do that. But I always find that funny, and here's why. Because there are people out there that think they can nail the day. Even though the scripture, if we just read our Bibles, wouldn't you agree, says no one knows the day or the hour. Even if I did pick a day and an hour, don't you think that's sort of comical on its own? Just even the simple, I just want to help these people. If you're out there and you're listening and you want to predict the day of the hour and the day, like, you're going to be wrong 23 times based on time zone alone. Don't you agree? I mean, it's just sort of obvious, right? So just on the time zones alone, you're going to be wrong. And on the day, for sure, half of the world is going to get it wrong. And so that's probably why Jesus said day or the hour. But he did tell us to watch and take heed. And I think wrongful predictions can kind of throw people off about places, dates, and they sort of disenchant people. But I would just say this, so what? It doesn't change the fact that it's still true. And we need to be brought back to the reality that our Bibles say there's coming a day when Jesus will rapture his church and then come back with his church. Amen? This is a fact if we call ourselves Christians. And if you're checking out God, Church, Jesus, or Faith, or you're watching on YouTube or by podcast, listen, I want to respectfully say, if you don't call yourself that and you're just checking it out, that's totally fine. But please understand, the Christian position is Jesus will come for his church. He will take them away and then he'll be with them for 7 years and then he'll return with them. The scriptures make it pretty clear. And the last year we looked at some of the predictions, like September 23rd, there was a prediction that, you know, that was going to be the rapture of the church because there was some movement in constellation systems and signs like that. And I said then, and I repeat this again, be careful. I don't see anything in the Bible that tells me that these signs in the heavens or in the stars meant the rapture would occur, like some other guys said. But I also think we have to be careful that some of us were too quick to dismiss. It's like September 24th coming, you go, oh, that's a waste. That's a joke. But that's not what the scriptures say. And I never said that either. Luke 21:25 says, before the return of Jesus, there will be signs in the stars. So don't discount that and go, oh, that's just a joke. So what? The constellations tell the story of Jesus' return. I would say, no, listen, when these things begin to happen, Jesus says, begin to look up your head because your redemption is close. So don't rule those out either. The second thing, first is predictions that people get wrong. The second thing is people's positions differ. And when it comes to prophecy, there's quite a few different ways to look at it. You got pre-trib and mid-trib and post-trib. Then there's pre-mill, a-mill, and post-mill. My mom says she's pan-mill. She says it's all going to pan out in the end. Amen? But different positions can cause disunity and division. And I say, look, we just need to stop that. If you differ from my opinion, that's fine. I have no problem with you being wrong about something. No, listen. But we have to operate with a sense of humility, wouldn't you agree? There is a sense of mystery around this, and there is a sense of need for us to know our Bibles and study to show ourselves approved, like the Bereans did. But we agree on certain things, and when it comes to this topic, we shouldn't be so offended. I read books all around the topic, and I kind of go, well, I know why that guy's saying that, because he believes that, and I don't believe that, but he's got some good stuff in there. And I think that that's a word that we need for today. We're not going to agree on everything, and we're not going to nail it all perfectly when we get there. As my mom always says, we all shall be surprised to some degree or another. And so I think that needs to be said, that we have to recognize that we walk this out with humility and that the main things we agree on, Jesus is coming, we'll be together forever, and that this life's not the main event. At least most of us agree on that, right? The third thing I see, which is important to mention when it comes to prophecy, is that life continues. Life continues. I think some of you can identify to this sort of picture. As you get into the new year, you're newly back at work, into the lives of others, dealing with junk and stress and finances, maybe some of you parenting and schooling and all these different things. And life just happens, and let's just be honest, when it comes to prophecy, if we're not realizing that two-thirds of our Bible is prophetic, we can just kind of get into this mode of, well, life happens and I forget about it. If your boss yells at you at work, I think you'd agree, your first response is not like, hey, why'd they yell at me? I wonder what Daniel's prophecy of the 10 toes means right now. That's just not where your brain goes. You're just dealing with junk and you're dealing with life. But the danger of this idea of life continues is that the very mark of the last days, and I believe this is written to Christians, 1 Peter says, is there's going to be this sort of life continues approach. 1 Peter talks about there's going to be scoffers in the last days, people that go, oh, come on, we've always said he's coming and he hasn't come yet. If you notice any of that, or if you feel that, hey, you're just playing in and helping the prophecy, we're closer than we've ever been. If that's your mentality, because you're fulfilling the same prophecy that Scripture talks about. Now, we're going to look at seven signs or markers that this is right in front of us. And to do that, we're going to jump back 2,600 years to a prophecy found in Ezekiel 38. But first, let's do some background on the passage, because I think this gets missed a lot, and I've never studied it this deeply, and it really helped me understand and put things in place. Ezekiel was a prophet of the first exile. Now, this is cool. Why? Because there's three prophets of the exile. Did you realize that the same time Ezekiel lived, Jeremiah lived? And did you realize that the same time Jeremiah lived, Daniel lived? That's interesting, isn't it? They're contemporaries at the same time, Ezekiel and Daniel. Ezekiel very well may have heard Jeremiah preach. How about that? It's kind of wild when you think of it. Because Jeremiah is in Jerusalem, he's teaching. Daniel, of course, is in Babylon at the court of Nebuchadnezzar that we've been walking through on Sundays. And Ezekiel is by the river Kabar in Babylon. Now, what's interesting about Ezekiel is that he's a little bit younger than Jeremiah. And he's a prophet, Jeremiah, that's speaking about the doom and the destruction that's going to happen to the city of Jerusalem. He's talking about how the temple's going to get destroyed, and the people of the day, they didn't believe him. He had zero converts for 40 years of ministry. I'd call that hard ministry, but the Bible says he was faithful. And Ezekiel was actually a priest, not a prophet. And as a young priest, he thinks, think about that. He's hearing Jeremiah condemn the priesthood, condemn the nation, and he's going to prophesy that Israel's going to go into captivity for 70 years. Remember that number. And so this is the message that Ezekiel is listening to around 622 to 570 BC. Well, in 606 BC, they get taken into captivity. And Ezekiel the prophet is taken in the first of three waves. They got taken in, they were exiled in 606, 597, and 587. And so Ezekiel is in captivity as a priest on his 30th birthday in the fifth year of captivity. He calls him to be a prophet. And so here's the captivity photo I got. It's not the real one from the day, sorry. But his ministry, here's a cool thing. He starts out as a priest, if you will, in a modern context, a pastor, and he changes to proclamational ministry. He's no longer doing that. And he becomes a prophet now. And he's in Jerusalem for 5 years as a prophet, predicting the fall of Jerusalem. Now, Israel's been exiled, but Jerusalem hasn't fallen yet. That's important. But he prophesied the city would fall, and exactly as he said it, because God gave him the words, it happened. And so his message in his book completely changes at this time from sort of this doom and gloom message to now chapters 33 to 39. He speaks of a future time when Israel would miraculously go from being almost extinct and scattered to being brought back into the land and form a nation. Now, it's easy to miss how significant this is. Think about this. Here's these people. Imagine if you are an Israelite in the day. And here's these people, and you are told, and your writings and your teachings and your connection with God are that God has supernaturally brought you into this land. So at this point, you think there's nothing you can do wrong. You're going to stay in this land. God brought you there. And now all of a sudden, you're in captivity. And that's why when you read through parts of the Psalms and when you read through certain laments, if you will, and lamentations and things like that, what you're seeing is a lot of this like, wow, why is this happening to us? Have you ever had a time like that in your life? Maybe recently, maybe now. Why is this happening to me? And this is such a great message for us as well, because we get in these times where literally it feels like we're in captivity. Maybe you're there today. You're just kind of trapped by something, and you're seeing, you think, has God forgotten me? That's really how Israel was at the moment. And they're thinking, this isn't supposed to happen to me. And Deuteronomy prophesied, as long as you stay faithful, you'll keep the land. But the Bible says what? They were unfaithful to God, and so they lost the land. And so the message of Ezekiel now changes to this new message, chapter 33 onward, and it goes like this. God is faithful. Maybe you need to hear this today. God is faithful. Yes, you're trapped. Yes, you're in captivity, but he will restore you and he will bring hope back into your life. Wherever you're at right now, God is faithful and he can restore you and bring hope back into your life. And the key words of that whole chunk are restoration and hope. And so the zinger for this hope that Israel has and we have too regarding end times starts really in Ezekiel 37 to 39. And it starts with this vision that Ezekiel gets from God to give to the people. And you can't, I don't think you can really see it from there. Maybe you can. But it's a vision of dry bones. It's quite graphic. It's very famous also. And he gets this vision in Ezekiel 37. And when he gets it, Israel is in the north. And the northern tribes have been taken into captivity in about 100 years before by the Assyrians. And so you have Israel and Judah divided, and they're in just a dry, desolate valley. And Ezekiel sees these dry bones representing this, and he's ordered to prophesy this by God and to show that these dead bones are going to come to life again. And so chapter 37, verse 9 to 14, he talks about how God is going to breathe on these bones that are sort of separated, if you will. And what he's talking about is that the breath will come into the bones and bodies and flesh will form, and the nation will be reborn again. And they're restored back into the land, but at first they have no life in them. In other words, they're living, but they're dead spiritually. And then he's commanded to take these two sticks and hold them together, and he joins them into one stick, meaning the two kingdoms that are torn apart will one day be united in one land. Then is in Ezekiel, he talks at the end of chapter 37, verse 24 to 28, just to summarize, of a greater son of David, that is Jesus. David's been long dead. Of Jesus the Messiah coming, and at a time when there is a temple, that's one of the three references we get of why there's a temple, and establishing authority and rulership, and he's going to be king over them, the people, and they're going to implicitly obey him, which is why we know this hasn't happened yet, along with many other reasons. And he's going to make an everlasting covenant with them, the temple's in their midst, and he establishes his kingdom and his reign forever. And this is found in, again, Ezekiel 37. But what we have here is in Ezekiel 38, 39, he says, before that day comes, or if you will, how this day lays out before the return of the king. And for Israel right now, they think it's their first coming of the Messiah. And that's why Israel, just so you know, if you're in Israel, the hope of all of Israel is that Israel gets established, Jerusalem gets established as his capital. The temple is built so that the Messiah can come. They don't believe that the Messiah can come until the temple's built. You'll see that if you come with us on an Israel tour. And so we're going to have some fun here. Let's lay down seven markers to see if we can match them with what's presently going on around us today as Ezekiel's vision in chapter 38 lays out just exactly how close we are. Look at verse 1 of chapter 38. Now the word of the Lord came to me saying, son of man, set your face against Gog of the land of Magog, the prince of Rosh, Meshech, and Tubal, and prophesy against him. And say, thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against you, O Gog, the prince of Rosh, Meshach, and Tubal. Now remember, Ezekiel's time, he's getting the names of the places in those days. So what we have to do and what scholars have done for us and people that study eschatology, that is the study of end times, is work through what those areas were and check what that country is presently today. So the prophecy begins with these words in your Bible in the opening verses here of warning to Gog and Magog. Now the word Gog, if you've got a pen, just circle the word Gog and close by in your Bible, simply write the word ruler or chief, you could say. Who's the ruler of the land of Magog? Well, in 500 BC, Greek historian Herodotus identified the land Magog as that of the Scythians, ancestors of the Russians. Now, Roman historian Flavius Josephus, who lived shortly after the time of Christ, also said Magog is the land we know as Russia. Now, throughout the centuries, scholars have identified Magog as Russia, due north of Israel, and even the Encyclopedia Britannica associates Russia with this land. Now, I told you this a couple years ago. There's a strong argument in this passage also for Turkey, and I think it's a very strong argument, And it's just what day you catch me on what I'm leaning towards. But that there's a suggestion that actually this Magog is a person, and he's the chief or president or prime minister over the area of Meshach and Tubal, which is present-day Turkey. And I think there's good arguments for both sides. But for the sake of this, I'm going to lean on the Russian for a little bit. If you're interested, we can chat more about that at some point. And so what we're going to see is either Russia leading Turkey or the other way around, they're going to come together and come against Israel. Look at verse 4. I will turn you around, put hooks into your jaws, and lead you out with all your army, horses and horsemen, all splendidly clothed, a great company with bucklers and shields, all of them handling swords. Marker number one. And what we're doing is we're asking, can we see these things that the Bible says in our present day today? Marker number one, is this Russia, or are Russia and Turkey moving troops towards Israel? Now, when scholars and eschatology and theologians looked at this passage for many years, and even at the start of my ministry, when I started in the ministry, they could never say, oh, this is happening right now. And they would give theories, well, maybe this will happen one day, maybe this will come about, but I believe what we're seeing right in front of our very eyes is Russia and Turkey moving troops towards Israel in this day. And it says something like this. It says something hooks these guys, if you will, like fishing. They're lured into battle. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. So we want to ask the question, is Russia and Turkey drawn towards Israel? And the answer is absolutely. For the first time in history. I mean, again, I just want to say this. I don't know how much this grabs you, but it kind of hits me. Every time I study for Prophecy Sunday, at some point in the study, because I usually start back in November just for fun, at some point I get hit with this reality of, oh my goodness, this is happening right now. And as I went through this teaching this time in this study, it hit me more times. More times did I come home and go, honey, I can't believe this is happening right in front of our eyes than ever before. And so this is an alliance that people would laugh at many years ago. We have what's called the Russo-Turkish Wars. These guys have been at odds, Turkey and Russia, for years, over 400 years. Starting as early as the 14th century, the 15th century, in 1568 they battled, in 1676 they battled, 1710, 1829, 1853, 1857, 1877, and the First World War. These guys have not been friends, get it? So pick your worst enemy and think of these guys. You're fighting all the time, fighting all the time. Maybe, hope they're not with you here today, but basically that's who these two guys are in the schoolyard. And so the idea of putting them together, why would God do that? Here's why I think. I think it's a way of God going, you'll know really clearly when the two guys that hate each other come together and march against Israel, you'll know really undoubtedly that I am at work here and that I'm doing something. Look what's going on. Here's how crazy it is. November 13th, just a few months ago, right? 3 months ago, Putin tells Erdogan, ties with Turkey are fully restored. So these two guys meet up in Sochi, and they have a sort of putting the past behind you meeting, if you will. And they also met another time, September 29th in Ankara. And now November 13th, last year, they meet, and they're back together. Well, what about, are they sending troops? And where would they send troops? How would they send troops to Israel? Well, we all know how they're sending troops to Israel. Because the nation right next to Israel, called Syria, is just a gong show right now. It's not a nation anymore. In fact, Russia calls it a state of Russia. Syria really doesn't exist in the sense of the word Syria. Russia now calls it a Russian state. Are they sending troops? Well, check it out. July 27th, 2017. Again, this is 5 months ago. And when we talked a year ago, the stuff that's happened in the last year is just incredible. Are they sending troops? Yes. Here's what Russia is doing. They built a base 5 months ago. They signed a deal with Syria to say, we're going to build military bases in there, and we're going to be there for 50 years just to make sure you guys are taken care of. That's what Putin signed with Syria. And so they now have 4 military bases in 5 months that they've built in Syria. What about Turkey? Turkey has established 8 million bases. Wow. They're everywhere. You just open your coffee. There it is. All right. 8 military bases in Syria's Idlib province. That was September 23rd, 2017. There's actually a guy that believes that from the Turkey, like Gog's Turkey camp, that believes that because Gog is Turkey, I wouldn't necessarily agree with this, but it's interesting that he believes that Erdogan, who is the prime minister of Turkey, is the Antichrist, and that if you, he's created a map that if you trace the Turkish army as they move towards Israel, it says right on the screen that the nearer they get towards Israel, the nearer that Jesus will get to Israel. His suggestion is once they arrive fully, and so he's sort of charted it out on his website that they're moving here, and they are. They're gradually moving further and further in. They've built military bases. They're sending tons of troops, and nobody can believe that these two nations that have hated each other historically are, quote-unquote, working together to help Syria. And of course, the excuse, not the reason, the excuse, no doubt, is ISIS. ISIS could be wiped out in a day. Everybody said that. But ISIS is an excuse to get everyone in the region to have control over the region. Absolutely. And so Turkey gets to Israel and closer and closer. Right now they're in the northern province and they're moving south. So they're there. Moving on, verse 5. Persia, Ethiopia, and Libya are all with them, all of them with shield and helmet. Gomer and all its troops, the house of Torgama from the far north and all its troops. Many people are with you. Prepare yourself and be ready, you and all your companies that are gathered about you, and be a guard for them. Okay, now it adds something that, again, seems preposterous. It says you got Russia and Turkey, and at the end there, Togarmah and Goma are also part of Turkey. But it says they're going to specifically grow up with three other, link up and align with three other nations, starting with Persia, which is present day where? Iran. In fact, if you meet Iranians today, most of them will call themselves Persian. They're kind of sort of pushing against that label of Iran. It says also Ethiopia, which is interesting because Ethiopia, the region in their day, is not Ethiopia in our day. It's actually Sudan. And the nation of Libya. So the second marker is another list of nations. The first marker I've given you is Turkey and Russia. The second one is another list of nations, Iran, Sudan, and Libya. And it's interesting, as we go to this second marker, all these nations, every single one, for the first time in history, are presently fighting right now in Syria, right next door to Israel. So the marker number two, they'll form a coalition or alliance with Iran and a couple other smaller nations. The question we're asking is this happening right now? The Bible says this will happen right before the return of Christ. They'll form this coalition with Iran and some other smaller nations. And so we're trying to figure out, how do we know? Has Persia, Iran, for instance, been drawn towards Israel? Are they in alliance with Russia and Turkey? This is amazing to me. Sometimes I just think, are we really recognizing this is happening? November 22nd, 2017, did you see this? Something happened recently in history that is of huge significance in prophecy. If you believe the Bible to be true and you follow this line of reasoning, look what happened just in November 22nd, 2017. Russia, Turkey, and Iran met. This is unreal, okay? The idea of these nations coming together is just incredible. Never before in the history of the human race have these three nations been aligned. Russia, Iran, and Turkey. And they said there was an alliance to basically sidestep previous American oversight, and that they will take care of establishing peace and safety in the region of Syria. How are they able to do this? I'm not blasting, I'm just giving you the facts. They're able to do this because in Obama's rule, he pulled back and told Russia, do your own thing. He inverted the Middle East policy. He did. I'm not going to get too political here. That's just a fact. Whether you're Democrat or Republican or whatever you are, those are the facts. He let Russia take the lead there. And because of that, there's this vacuum that's created in Syria. Well, Russia is like, thank you, Obama, stepped up to the plate and said, we'll run with this. And the U.S. is no longer a player here. And so Iran in November of last year, 3 months ago, church, 3 months ago, started building military bases just south of Damascus. So you've got the entire nation of Syria, which is pretty big. Where did they put their military bases? Any guesses? Right on the southern tip of Syria. Damascus, which is right next to what border? Israel. Some say, oh, it's 35, 40. Some say 45, 50 kilometers. I don't really know. But we know that they've built a base right there. And interesting, why would Iran want to do that? Just for peacekeeping, obviously, right? I mean, just to build relationships with you know, the infidel nation Israel, who they've said they want to wipe off the map. Probably that. And so when they did this, coincidentally, Russia announced, coincidentally, that Syria was now considered a Russian state. Goodbye, Syria, as we knew. And that anyone, meaning Israel, that's what they mean, anyone that attacks Syria or Syrian forces would be like they are attacking Russia. They did this. Iran built this military base some 35, 40 kilometers outside of Israel. You can pretty much, if you stand on the Golan Heights with us in Israel, you can point at Damascus. It's really trippy when you're there with a group. You're like, that's Damascus right there. And everyone's eyes are huge. And you're way up on this huge mountain. Looking down, you see it. And so just on the southern part of Damascus, like on this side of Israel, there's this military base. And then Russia says, oh, don't attack anything, not Israel, but anyone, don't attack Syria or you're attacking us. And they built this base right there, started bringing weapons in. What is it? What does Israel do? What's their response? They bombed it. They bombed it and they took it out. And Netanyahu said, I really don't care. We're going to defend our nation against people that have said, we want to wipe you off the face of the map. And we're not going to let a military base be that close. So it is heating up. Iran has said all along its goal is the destruction of Israel. You say, well, Joel, what about the protests that are happening right now? Well, I would just say, you know, I don't really know. It's kind of new. I know there's, you know, the people have, I know CNN took the picture of the lady with the white flag. It's not a white flag. It's a hijab. She's taking it off and protesting about women's rights. And I know that in America, the women's rights movements are doing nothing. They're not raising their voice at all. Why? Because they're also the same movement that support Islam and don't want to be accused of Islamophobia. So you have that, but you also have a dictatorship and you have an Islamic state and Sharia law being implemented. And when you have that set up, it's incredibly oppressive. I mean, understand this, ladies, this is sick, but it just gives you an idea. Why would you protest Sharia law if it came into your nation and brought order to your nation? Because the rules of Sharia law are disgusting. You know, sexually, any virgins have to service sexually any military that come through your town during Sharia law. That's just a rule of Sharia law. That's just one rule of Sharia law. So it is completely oppressive, and they're pushing back from that. Verse 8, after many days, you'll be visited. That has got to be the biggest understatement of you're getting a visitor in the Bible, by the way. Hey, Russia, Turkey, Iran, you have a visitor at the door. This is very understated. In the latter years, you'll come into the land of those brought back from the sword. Here's a marker. And gathered from many people on the mountains of Israel, which had long been desolate. They were brought out of all the nations, and now all of them dwell safely. So then he says, this will be in the latter days. I don't know if it's a marker, but it's definitely a sign and a reminder that God says this is going to happen in the last days. But then he gives a marker as to how closer, what days those days will be for us, which I find incredibly important. Marker number 3, the nation of Israel will exist in the last days. Now you say, well, Joel, that's sort of obvious, isn't it? Well, it's obvious to us. But it's no small thing prophetically, and it's no small feat, if you will, humanly. See, after Rome took over Jerusalem and destroyed the temple in AD 70, they were scattered, the Jews, worldwide in what's called the diaspora. They just went throughout the world. And so now if a Jew decides he's going to come back from one of the nations that he went to, his family, if he decides he's going to return, it's called Aliyah, and they're making this return. Do you know what Israel's doing right now? They have said anyone under the age of 25 can make Aliyah, can return for free. Israel will pay for you to go back to the motherland. So Jews are returning like en masse right now. In fact, my financial advisor at my bank, he's Jewish, and I get to share Jesus with him a lot. We've had some incredible talks. Pray for him. And he's over 25, but the last meeting I had with him, he said, Joel, this is so exciting because I think he's 34 or 33. And he said, they just added 10 more years. They want everyone to come back to Israel on or before the 70th anniversary of Israel this year. And he said, yeah, it's kind of cool. There's this buzz about will the Messiah come back on the 70th year? And so he's heard of people that are waving flags, welcoming the Messiah back for this coming year, 2018, in Israel, which I just think is amazing. And so in 1948, never happened before, this nation was reformed again. Now think about that. None of the other nations from this time period of history when Israel was formed have ever returned. You will never meet a guy, ladies, if a guy tries to, like, you know, give you some suave line and he's like, hey, I'm from Philistine. That's not true. You know, I'm a Canaanite. No, they're gone. The Amorites, the Hittites, all of them wiped off the face of the earth, never to return. There's one nation, the Israelites, who are still around today, and they have returned. And so he says here, you know, Isaiah writes a prophecy about this. He says, can a nation be reborn in a day? Ezekiel's prophecy suggests it's going to happen. They're going to come out of the dry and the wilderness. And right here it says in Ezekiel that he's going to gather them back. He's going to gather them out of the place they've been scattered and bring them back. And then he says this, to the mountains of Israel. This is an incredible marker in my mind. The mountains of Israel. Now that's a marker right there. Why? In 1948, when Israel became a nation, they didn't have the mountains of Israel, also known as the Golan Heights. If you look on the map here on the left side of the map, this is before, if you will, this is in 1948, this is what their map looked like. So you can see the Israel part is in the lighter tan color, and the darker tan or brown on the right is everything not Israel. And the West Bank was currently run at the time, I believe it was called the Transjordan, they called that area. It's an intermediate name because it wasn't really Jordan's, but they called it Transjordan. And the Golan Heights were, of course, in Syria. And they were the defensive position in Syria. So they, if you go today with us, and again, the deadline I think is like two weeks away or something. But if you come with us, you're going to see it is massive. You're way up on the hilltop looking down. Israel is indefensible if they give up the Golan Heights. And that's why there's been a lot of Palestinian PLO leaders who've said, well, you know what, we want peace with you guys and let's trade land for peace, which has never produced peace, by the way. Don't be fooled. It's never produced peace. Israel wants peace and they've gone for peace, but it's never worked. Every time they give up land for peace, like in the Gaza Strip, it turns into a war zone. It just does. And they start shooting rockets at Israel. And I'm not saying Israel's all innocent. Don't miss this. I'm just giving us a biblical context into a present reality. But here's what happened. In 1948, Israel did not have the mountains of Israel, this fourth marker. So you could say in 1948, if you looked at Ezekiel 38, this prophecy can't be fulfilled because there are no mountains in Israel. Until what? Until in 1967. 1967, something happened, which was a clear marker that we are in the days of this prophecy. Some 19 years after its independence in 1967, we have something, there's the Golan Heights, that just shows you when you're high up looking down. We have what's called the Six-Day War. And it was the war after its independence. Israel fought the Six-Day War, as it was referred to, and defended herself on all sides from many enemies. And in that war, they won back the Golan Heights, the mountains of Israel. And they won back Jerusalem, and they won back the Temple Mount. It was an incredible day. And if you, for fun, want to study the Six-Day War, there's a good book out there. There's two good books out there I'll recommend to you privately. And one of the names is gone from me right now, but I have it in my library. And it's just incredible that even the Jews will tell stories of the Six-Day War, how God did things. Like, there's a tank battalion that it's like one guy defended against, Dan, you know, we've read this, I can't remember how many it was, like 200 tanks, and took them all out. Like, it's incredible. You see the hand of the Lord, and the Bible says that they'll fight as one man against many, and it'll be as if there are 1,000 men fighting. And that war was exactly like that. It was so clear God fought for them. And so they're attacked in these days, and it wasn't fulfilled in any other time in history. So guys, for us, we have to realize it must be fulfilled. Again, here's another marker. After 1967, on the Golan Heights, which is right beside, of course, Syria. Not only that, but it says right here in Ezekiel 38 that it was a desolate land when they came into it, when their nation was regathered. Well, Israel was not desolate in Jesus' day, but they were scattered in AD 70, and it became a barren wasteland. Mark Twain, when he visited Israel in 1867, he described a country that was, he said, desolate, devoid of vegetation and human population, hardly a tree or shrub anywhere. Now stay with me. Verse 9, you'll ascend, coming like a storm, covering the land like a cloud, you and all your troops and many peoples with you. So it's going to be on the mountains of Israel. So we know that's the Golan Heights. And this enemy is going to sort of come and cover over with many other nations, this coalition, to attack Israel. Here's the fifth marker. None of these nations specifically border Israel. Now this seems small. It maybe seems insignificant to you. You go, well, who cares if none of them actually border Israel? But I actually think, again, it's another marker that we are presently living in the day where this is happening. How could any of these nations presently attack Israel without being seen, if you want to just start there? Because listen, none of these nations are anywhere near Israel. If you check the map here, you can see, and if that's a difficult map, Israel's the one being pointed to. You see where Israel's name is out in the ocean because it doesn't fit in the country, that's how small it is. The nations around it are Egypt, Jordan, and Syria. Syria's not mentioned in this battle that comes against the Golan Heights. Does that seem strange? Like forever, historians, scholars, people that study eschatology, the study of end times have gone, well, that's kind of weird. We don't know how they're going to attack through the Golan Heights without going through Syria. Make sense? Unless they kind of like airdrop. And the reason is, today, guys, Syria's gone. It is now just a battle zone setting up, I believe, for the final battle. All of the nations, this is not as good a graphic, but it will hopefully help you see. All of the nations are in the colors here are the ones that are going to attack. But you notice the ones surrounding Israel do not get mentioned in the Bible here. This is incredible. I want you to think about this. The nations that surround Israel right now, for the first time, some of these nations who've been at war with Israel, Jordan, who they took land from. Jordan is at relative peace with Israel right now. Petra is the place that the Bible says the Jews will flee to. That's another sermon, but they're at peace. Egypt is at peace with Israel right now. Right now, Egypt, who's done battle and war with Israel, they are at peace right now with Israel. And Syria doesn't really exist. Syria is just not a player in there. So this is an incredible marker that's happening right now. I mean, Russia decides to attack Israel. If they decided to attack Israel and there was no Syria, imagine all their troops moving slowly across the map. Israel would see it on satellite. America would come in. There'd be World War III, no doubt. But that's not what's happening. Instead, Russia, unhindered, are building military bases, setting up troops, bringing tanks. Did you know that Russia has given missile defense systems to Syria and placed them along the borders of Syria? And so that an Israeli plane was shot not too long ago, just a few months back, I believe. It was shot, and it survived. But the missile system that shot it was from Russia. And of course, Russia is doing that to defend Syria against ISIS. Guess what? Russia predominantly is not even fighting ISIS in Syria right now. Many of you are nodding because you're staying with this. Some of you have traveled with me on this, or you know for your own studies. They're not really fighting ISIS. ISIS is just the excuse. That is not what's happening. And so Russia is just building and massing up troops here. But just remember that when we talk about ISIS, we talk about, ISIS, the greatest problem. No, ISIS is just an excuse right now. If it wasn't for ISIS, Russia couldn't come into Syria. If it wasn't for ISIS, Iran couldn't come into Syria. If it wasn't for ISIS, Turkey wouldn't invade into the northern part of Syria like they are right now. All these groups and nations are hanging their coats on ISIS. But again, ISIS is serving a purpose for all of them. But it is the excuse, not the real reason for what's going on. Verse 10, thus says the Lord God, on that day it shall come to pass that thoughts will arise in your mind, speaking of this evil king, tyrant, or leader to come against Israel, and you will make an evil plan. You will say, I will go up against the land of unwalled villages. I will go to a peaceful people who dwell safely, all of them dwelling without walls and having neither bars nor gates. Verse 11 says they dwell in peace and safely. And they do, relatively, if you come today. In fact, the two biggest reasons people don't come on an Israel tour with us, number one, they're either scared. Another one, they can't afford it. Number two, they're scared of what might happen. Those are the top two reasons people don't do an Israel tour. And I would just challenge that and say, ask anyone that's been, would you just do for fun for a second, stand up if you've ever been on an Israel tour with us. Stand up. Okay. Now, sit down if you were freaked out of your mind on that tour. Go ahead. Okay, so would you agree with me? Sorry to put you on the spot, all 20 of you, but you don't feel that when you're there, right? You can have a seat now. Great job. Give him a big hand. Good job, guys. Audience participation. Well done. When you're there, in fact, I can't speak for you because I'll sound like a salesperson too late, but you just feel like it's a second home. You feel like you're at peace, and if you come to Israel, they're living like we do here, just with better falafels. And there's no gates, and there are bars, but they're different. They're not bars to keep them out. They're just that people go to them. But anyway, everybody loves visiting Israel, and Israel genuinely wants peace. This is a huge thing for Israel. Now, we know that the Antichrist will come with a veiled peace, and he's going to come and offer that. And you can see that in the people. Their number one thing is they're like, we want peace. And again, that's when I talked with my Jewish bank advisor. I said, what are the top three things you want? He said, peace. We want Jerusalem recognized. We want the temple rebuilt so the Messiah can come back. And so that's why this is such a huge deal. You know, when you talk about, people say, well, what's the big deal? So Trump declares that Jerusalem is the capital. Who cares, Joel, what Trump thinks? And there's part of me, I go, I get what you're saying, okay? Honestly, I get what you're saying. I'm not condoning this guy. What I'm trying to say is that everybody wants peace, and they want the building of the third temple, just as the Bible says. And I got some guys online were saying, oh, come on, Joel, who cares what he wants? But this move is much bigger. What he's saying is much bigger than just what Trump wants or says. The riots, the protests, the plans for war are happening because he lit the match, if you will, or the wick, if you will, to this tinderbox. And you say, well, Joel, that's not really in the Bible. That's just his opinion of it. No, that's not true. Okay. Zechariah 12. If you got a Bible, turn there. Zechariah 12:2. I'll just show you it quickly. That's what it says, Zechariah 12:2. Behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of drunkenness to all the surrounding peoples when they lay siege against Judah and Jerusalem. When does this happen? When does this happen? Read Zechariah, right before Israel sees the one whom they've pierced, Jesus. Zechariah 12 is about before the return of Jesus, the world is going to be intoxicated with the topic of Jerusalem. And they're going to be fighting and protesting and battling over Jerusalem. So when you kind of drop in the middle of this area that is all surrounding Israel Muslim, and you say, well, we think that that is the capital of Israel, you are just starting something that is huge. And so this whole idea of peace and safety, we looked at it last year, it is just the mantra of the day. And it is the very sign 1 Thessalonians says will come right before his return. Here's what 1 Thessalonians says. For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them. Just a couple months ago, the UN had a peace summit. What was their slogan for it? Peace, safety, dignity, respect. Peace and safety. And you've seen, go online, they use the term peace and safety, peace and safety. Trump's very speech about Jerusalem was peace and safety. Okay, where are they, and okay, why are they coming against Israel? At least why do we think, or what does the scripture tell us? Look at verse 12. Verse 12 says, to take plunder and to take booty, to stretch out your hand against the waste places that are again inhabited and against a people gathered from the nations who've acquired livestock and goods who dwell in the midst of the land. Sheba, Dedan, the merchants of Tarshish, and all their young lions will say to you, have you come to take plunder? Have you gathered your army to take booty, to carry away silver and gold, to take away livestock and goods, to take great plunder? What's the sixth marker? They come to take booty. It's just the best word, isn't it? Anyway, I should have called this sermon Booty and the Beast. But anyway, it says right here in verse 12, that the leader of Gog and Magog, Russia's leader, will come to take something that does not belong to him, plunder and booty. Do we have a leader, friends, in Russia right now, presently, who likes to take things that don't belong to him? Hello, Ukraine. Hello, Crimea. And he's moved into Syria, and right now, he is bombing. You know, don't be fooled by the videos. The media figured it out in Russia a few years ago that if we, about 10, 15 years ago, we need to change the image of Putin. And so they've got him doing all these like manly things, you know, and they're like, oh, Putin riding a bear. Okay, it's not true. But, you know, it's just, here's Putin in the water, you know, spear fishing or whatever. He's got his shirt off, and it's like, Putin. And they try to make some interviews, and Christians would say, oh, you know, this seems like a nice guy. Right now, here's a fact. This may offend you, but this is a fact. Just yesterday, Putin bombed women and children in an area. Why do we not hear about it? I have no idea. I would call that spiritual. I would say if America bombed women and children, they'd be like blowing horns and everything. But that just happened yesterday. It's incredible what they're doing right now in Syria. They are just completely destroying lives, and nobody cares. NATO asked him to stop, and he doesn't care. He's moving more and more troops into the area, and he's shelling, and he's bombing, and they built 4 bases in Syria. He parked the largest nuclear submarine in the world. It's owned by Russia. It's got a weird name. It's like Donetsky or something. It's massive. It's like 575 feet. It has over 200 missiles on it, 120 warheads. He parked that off the coast of Syria. He's basically, of course, protecting Syria. Now he's taken that same submarine just recently, and he's moved it into the Baltic area, which is called NATO's swimming pool. And he's parked it right in the middle, just to sort of say, in your face. That's basically what he's done. And he surfaced it because it doesn't have the depth for this massive submarine. If you've seen the movie Hunt for Red October, anybody? It's that sub. The Typhoon class, it's that one, it's the remaining one, the only one that's operational today. They parked it in the Baltic Sea, and he's got it surfacing. Go look it up. All this is, you can fact check on me, and you'll see he's just riding it around to say, in your face, NATO, I'm not scared of you anymore. Because there was a while there, many years ago, after the Cold War, and they couldn't afford to operate even their submarines. They didn't have the funds. But now they've linked up with Iran, and they're trading nuclear technology with Iran, and they're getting oil from Iran, and they're running huge pipes from Iran and other places. Now the money's starting to come back. The old war machine from 30 years ago is bigger and better than it ever was before. Don't kid yourselves. It's amazing some of the stuff that is happening there. So what's the lure, Joel? What's the fish hooks, if you will, that it says here, that draws them into battle with Israel? Well, we don't know exactly. That's an interesting one. It'll be interesting, but I've got some pretty good guesses. 6 years ago, they discovered a massive gas field appropriately named Leviathan off the coast of Israel. This is huge. They suggest this will provide endless energy to Israel, and they have no need for any more renewable resources. I also know that on the Golan Heights, just 24 months ago, just think about that, just 2 years ago, they discovered a massive oil reserve on the very mountains of Israel. Did you hear me? That's a marker of billions and billions of barrels of oil. And Russia needs what? Oil. And that's an interesting thing. That's no secret. You can look that up. You'll find it out. It may not be that specific. It may simply be the spoils of war that Putin, just like he did with Crimea, but I think there's more to it. If you trace back all the battles where Russia's involved against Israel, guess what? Where Russia's not involved against Israel, what do they find after the battles? Russian technology, Russian weapons, Russian missiles. So Russia has it in for Israel, there's no doubt. Does Turkey have it in for Israel? Oh, absolutely. Erdogan went just recently said we should wipe all Jews off the face of the earth when he read the Hadith, and he read it on national TV. There's no doubt. Does Iran? Oh, Iran, that's their singular mission, is to destroy Israel. Now, side note that leads us to our last marker. In verse 13, it says, Sheba Dedan. And that is interesting. Why? If you look at verse 13, Sheba Dedan is sort of going, whoa, time out, what's going on here? Time out, you guys can't do this. It looks like you're coming for plunder and booty that's not yours. Why are you doing this? Where is Sheba and Dedan today? Saudi Arabia. And right now they're aligned with Israel, which is interesting. And so they are, at the time of this battle, saying, hey guys, whoa, time out. It looks like you're after their oil or riches of the land. And interesting that the Muslim struggle in the Middle East has always been between two nations, Iran and Saudi Arabia. And so here Saudi Arabia is sort of going, time out, why are you marching into Israel? You want their riches, don't you? But that brings up another rather interesting, potentially alarming final marker, marker number 7, and it's this. The nations that aren't mentioned. I don't know if you thought about that looking at this passage, but what about the nations that aren't mentioned in this passage? What about the ones that aren't included in this? Where's Egypt? They're not involved. Where's Iraq? They're not involved. And we know now, living in our day, why Egypt's not involved, because they're now at peace with Israel. And that's the first time. Who attacked Israel in the Six-Day War in 1967? Egypt. What did Israel do? They sent bombers in and bombed all the air bases so Egypt couldn't get their planes in the air. That's essentially what ended the Six-Day War within a matter of hours. That's essentially what happened. And then Egypt sent up their tanks and they took them out with minimum tanks. Just totally the hand of the Lord. But this is the nation that not too long ago, 40 years ago, was like, or 50 years ago, was like, let's wipe these guys off the face of the map. Now they are in peace alignment. Peace, if you will. What about Iraq? Well, we all know what happened to Iraq. They got eliminated. That's why they're not in here. Iraq, who hates Israel, wants their destruction, of course, got overthrown and went through this war. So that's why they're not in here. It's all here. It's astounding to me. And most alarmingly for some, perhaps, is how come America isn't mentioned? It's the great question. I have a lot of friends in the States. I've been, over the last year, getting to speak there more and more, and it's been a real blessing. And so it's always kind of a fun thing. They're like, hey, Joel, why aren't we mentioned in the end times, right? Kind of like, well, I leave out the fact that Canada's not in there either, but they don't seem to care. But anyway, I'm like, well, never mind you, we're not in there. I thought we'd be coming at them with our Zambonis. But anyway, basically they're like, how come, you know? Why are we not in there? But here's the interesting thing. Let's do a nice case scenario, best case scenario, and then let's do a worst case scenario, and then we're almost done. We'll wrap up here. Best case scenario, why is America not in this battle? Best case scenario, this is really going to sound a little doom and gloom, but I promise I'm just trying to preach what the word says here. Best case scenario is they're not in there politically because Obama pulled them out politically. So they don't have a say anymore. An alliance of Iran, Turkey, Russia came in and are now, what they did just a couple months ago is they said, let's divide up the zones of Syria. You police this zone, we'll police that zone, and we'll police that zone, which, by the way, Russia's ignoring. But anyway, that's what they're saying. We're going to divide up these zones, and Turkey's ignoring too because they're coming past the border. But we'll each look after this, and don't worry, Assad, who's a crazy nut man who bombed his own people with chemical weapons, side note. But don't worry, Assad, because we're here for you. We're going to divide this nation up. We'll all come in. Isn't this incredible? Church, are you seeing this? It's happening right today. It's right in front of our eyes. Why is America not involved? Let's get back to the question. Best case scenario, because politically, Obama pulled the plug and said, yeah, I don't really care. You guys go ahead. And Putin said, no problem, and took in. And now all this is going on. So best case scenario, it happens so fast politically, America's not in there. I still think that's a bit weak, don't you? Don't you think America would defend Israel? So if you are an American friend watching this right now, just come back 5 minutes later and catch the end of the sermon. Because here's what I think is more likely. Some people suggest, well, maybe it's financial. And maybe it is. Things change really fast, wouldn't you agree? Financially, we saw that in the recession. Perhaps that'll turn around, and financially, the bottom will fall out. I don't see that right now. Whatever you think of Trump, the economy, American economy, from all sides I've seen is going like this. So maybe it is that, but something pretty significant would have to happen. I think more than likely you're going to see something like America gets into a war. Possibly, probably the most likely is North Korea or Iran. But I mean, let's just look at the facts, and most Americans see this. CNN reported the new missile test shows North Korea is capable of hitting all of the U.S. mainland. And the Canadians will love, some of my friends are like, oh, great, isn't, praise the Lord, it's not us. I'm like, you know 90% of us live within 60 miles of the border, right? You do know that. I'm like, you know, maybe your friend that lives in, give me a northern, come on here. What is that? Iqaluit? I should know how to say that. Anyway, if you got a buddy there, he might be good to go. Call him up. Hey, you're safe. You might not be in end times, but you're far enough away. But the bottom line is, this is a game changer. When this intercontinental, what's called a ICBM, intercontinental ballistic missile, was fired, America immediately said, we have missed North Korea and underestimated them by 5 years of technology. And it's the second time they've done it in 2 years. In other words, reports suggest that twice now in 2 years they've said, oh, North Korea is just a crazy man with his finger on the button. We don't have to worry about him, right? Rocket man. No problem. He'll be fine. Kim Jong-young. He's just whatever. We don't have to worry about him. Twice now they've said it's 5 years advanced, more than we thought. How can it advance so fast in Korea? Who's tied with Korea? Iran. Who? Oh, this is going to make me angry. And some of you also. I hope it does. Who's helping Iran with their nuclear technology, or did? America. Is this unreal? Who sent, what is it, 4 airplanes, Carol? Something like 4 full 747s full of cash to Iran to repay a bill. Obama did. Supplying them with money, mostly for terrorism, because it's all in different currencies from different nations. What was the number? I don't know. Does someone know? Billions and billions. Thank you. Billions and billions of military bases. Sorry, just seeing if you're listening. Okay. Unbelievable. And so Korea now has the ability, when they launch this intercontinental ballistic missile, they have the ability, if you will, to send it through the atmosphere into space and, no, not yet, into space and detonate it. Now that's a big deal. Why? Well, here's why. Have a look. I'll show you something and then see if you can picture this, and we'll wrap up here in just a minute. The Daily Star out of England, a notable, reputable paper in England, they said, very bad day for the U.S. They call a blackout drill for crisis that could kill 300 million on November 6th. Okay? Just 2 months ago, exactly, right? It's the 7th today. 2 months ago, they called a blackout drill all across California. Friends of mine told me about this. The White House is preparing for the threat of disastrous blackouts across the U.S. Drill from November 4th to 6th across more than 3,000 U.S. counties. Military commanders will practice for a situation when the whole nation is plunged into chaos by a mass failure of the power grid. Why would they do this? Three letters. Anyone? E-M-P. E-M-P. Because nobody knew that North Korea had an ICBM. And now they do. The greatest risk we have here is not that we think they're nuke capable, is that we know that if they launch this ICBM, they could pick any nation on the planet, not just America. And if they detonated above that nation far enough, like a cone, they could take out electronics. This is a real threat. I have friends in California that said they did a drill. They were part of the drill where they were, and they knew they couldn't call it an EMP, so they called it a power grid failure drill. But it's the same reason. They're prepping for an EMP that is coming. You say, why is America not mentioned in end times? My best shot is right now, just, and don't quote me on this, but perhaps North Korea actually does it this year. Who knows? It could propel things. It would cripple them instantly, and it would propel everyone back into the 1800s. Perhaps it's that, perhaps it's something else. Along with that, it's also interesting who's not mentioned in the battle, Iraq, as we said, and Syria. And it's also fascinating that Syria, which is the nation which is bordering the mountains, is not even mentioned here. Now, if you continue reading into 39, and we don't have time to, you get to this. And I will send fire on Magog. This is what happens to these armies coming on the Golan Heights against Israel. And on those who live in security in the coastlands, then they shall know that I am the Lord, so I will make my holy name known in the midst of my people Israel, and I will not let them profane my holy name anymore. Then the nation shall know I am the Lord, the Holy One in Israel. Surely it is coming and shall be done, says the Lord. This is the day of which I have spoken. And it goes on to tell us that God completely obliterates sending fire on them. Is it nuclear? Perhaps. Certainly Ezekiel 39, read it on your own time, looks like a cleanup from a nuke. It says they have people with special suits and protective suits that go around and pick out remains and mark them. And it's polluted land for 7 years. That's an interesting number. And so let's have some fun. I'm going to say how I see this going. Then we'll call the worship team up. We'll close with a song here. How's this going? How could I see this going for the starting year? I think you've got the 70th year this year, the year of celebration in Israel, marking their 70th. It's their year of Jubilee. They are waving flags. I think potentially you could have something in 2018 between North Korea and America, or you could have some financial upside down thing. I think just alone the fact that Trump is going to do what every president said before they made it part of their manifesto, that we're going to move the embassy to Jerusalem. I think he's going to go for it. And I think that's going to, again, light the wick for all the Muslim nations around it. I believe you could. I'm never going to be the one to tell you the rapture of the church is this year, next Friday. Get ready, pack your bags. But I will tell you that I could fully see it coming any day. Russia, Turkey, Iran, I see will move on Israel. They're already doing it. I believe the U.S. won't be a player anymore, and so they're going to try and seize the Golan Heights, which is the vantage point. I believe that God intervenes, whether it's through a nuke or it's just in person, not sure. It says he'll rain down fire. 7 years they're going to clean up. I believe a world leader, an antichrist, will appear with a peace solution because of all the war that's going on. I'm not saying all this happens in 2018. I'm just saying this is the progression I see. I believe he's going to try and create a solution of the three world religions, and the promise is going to be what the Bible says. We'll look at it soon in a few weeks in Daniel. He's going to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem and possibly at a different site, which people have not really thought much about. The seven-year peace treaty is going to be signed by Israel because they want their temple and they want their Messiah. That's the key. And they won't get their Messiah till it's built. And 3.5 years in, they're going to realize this is a bad tyrant leader. He's going to break treaty with Israel, declare himself God, and demand worship. Israel then is under attack. They fight and flee. Jerusalem is surrounded. Jesus shows up in really what's been called a three-pronged or three-stage return, first to Petra to encourage them, then Jerusalem, where Israel realizes their Messiah, where they look upon the one who with nail-pierced hands and mourn as for an only son, Zechariah 12, where he destroys the Antichrist at the Battle of Armageddon, which is sort of funny because really, I hate to say this, but you shouldn't really call it the Battle of Armageddon. There is no battle. Everybody shows up to fight, and Jesus goes, wow, he's got really bad breath, and everybody dies. And there's no Battle of Armageddon. There's Armageddon, and there's a battle forming, but Jesus ends it like that. We're on horses, by the way, with him, so that's pretty sweet. You'll have front row seats for that one if you don't come with us in March. Am I going too fast? Good. Who's the Antichrist? We'll talk about that in a couple weeks when we hit Daniel 9, 24 to 27. So, as we wrap up and the worship team comes up, I just want to remind you, 2,600 years ago, Ezekiel encouraged Israel that their Messiah will come on a day, will take out their enemies, and will set up his throne, and will reign and rule forever, forever. Ezekiel 39, verse 8, surely it is coming, and it shall be done, says the Lord God. This is the day of which I have spoken, just as God said. Turn to the last passage in Scripture in the Bible. It's not in my notes, but it's on my heart. So let's find it together. The very last in Revelation. Go from Genesis to maps and then go left one block and you'll hit Revelation. The last words in the Bible. Revelation 22, verse 20. Would you stand with me, church? He who testifies, that is, the word means witness. He who witnesses these things says, surely I am coming quickly. The Greek word quickly is the word tacos, not tacos, as in Mexico, praise God for them, but tacos, the Greek word. The word tacos, we get our word tachometer, right? And it speaks of revving up. People read this verse through the years and they've gone, well, Jesus isn't coming. He said he was coming quickly. It's been 2,000 years. What he tried to tell us and imprint in our minds and hearts is the season when he comes, it will be revving up, getting faster and faster. And I believe we're living in those days. Amen?